Hi guys, Amaris here. Today we're checking if we can run Windows 2K on this Ryzen 9 9900X CPU while booting from a Kingston Renegade Fury Gen 5 2TB NVMe SSD. So yeah, we're setting pretty high standards for Windows 2000, but I'm counting on the same backported drivers that worked great on a socket 1200 build with an i5 10th Gen CPU. Also, the AM5 build you might have already seen running Windows 95 and 98 is getting two big upgrades. I mean, literally big. It's time to move all the hardware into a new case that can fit the Liquid Freezer 420 Pro that Arctic sent me. Thanks, Arctic. I specifically requested this model. I could have gone with a more standard 360 AIO, but no, I had to go for the big one. The thing is, about 80% of all cases are not compatible with such large AIOs. The good part is that the ones that are compatible are usually high-end models, so the odds are better if you are after a high-end case anyway. And this is how I landed on the DarkFlash DY51L Pro case, which is part of what they call their luxury series. Besides its compatibility with large AIOs, I liked that it has 9 brackets on the back for a theoretical 9 PCI slot configuration. So basically we can mount 2 double slot GPUs to regular PCIe cards and still have room for some extra brackets like a serial port, extra USBs or an eSATA bracket. Also the bottom PCIe X16 slot has plenty of clearance for a double slot or even a larger GPU. So yes, there is more than enough space to move everything from the open air test bench into this new roomy home. And best of all, it can easily accommodate the Arctic Liquid Freezer 3 420 Pro ARGB, which mounts neatly on the side. Now we are upgrading from a capable air cooler, the Arctic Freezer 36. This thing could handle a chip like the Ryzen 9 9900X, but we're planning for the future here, for the real heavyweight champions like the Ryzen 9 9950X3D. For that we need a cooling power rated for 170 watts TDP, and that jump in cooling performance is exactly what makes an AIO more complex to install. Slapping on an air cooler is no big deal, but with a liquid cooler, you've got some decisions to make. So let's talk about that. Here's the golden rule you need to know. Every AIO has a small amount of air in the loop, and our one job is to make sure that the air bubble ends up anywhere but the pump, which is usually mounted on the CPU. You want the air to be trapped at the highest point in the loop. Since the pump is on the CPU and this radiator is huge, no matter how we mount it, the pump will be always the lowest point, so we're good. The ideal scenario is to mount the radiator with the tubes at the bottom. I tried that first, but there wasn't enough clearance because this case doesn't leave room for the tubes. Yes, there is a removable bottom panel that could create enough space, but without it, there would be a lot of exposed cables from the fan controller, and it just doesn't look good. So plan B, tubes at the top. This configuration actually gets a green check mark in the manual, with a small note that it can cause the bubbling. Well, we'll see about that. The setup hit a slight detour when I realized I'd mounted the brackets upside down, which completely prevented the cold plate from screwing in. However, briefly removing the cold plate showed that the X pattern recommended by Arctic for applying their MX6 thermal paste actually works very well. Once I mounted the brackets in the correct position, the cold plate could be, of course, easily screwed in. You might also notice something unusual for a cooling system. The top of the CPU remains a bit exposed. That's because the hotspot on AM5 CPUs is a bit off-center, so the cold plate is positioned a bit lower for the best possible heat transfer. When we mount the final piece, the faceplate, this will cover the entire CPU socket and everything will look good. I think the faceplate is where AIOs really shine compared to air coolers. It's clean, minimal, and lets you focus on the lighting and other aesthetics in your case, which, let's be honest, is a big part of why we choose liquid cooling in the first place. And the final result? Well, so far so good, no bubbling, no drama, just a cool and quiet CPU idling happily around 40 degrees Celsius. Alright, let's dive into Windows 2000. Now, spoiler alert, it does run, but it wasn't easy to get there. Here's how it all went down. The first thing I wanted to check was if Windows 2000 would boot from the Kingston NVMe drive I already had set up in a dual boot configuration with Windows 98 on the first partition and Windows 11 on another. Now, obviously, a stock copy of Windows 2000 won't recognize an NVMe drive, since native support didn't arrive until Windows 8.1 in 2013. Fortunately, there is a custom build of Windows 2000 that integrates NVMe, USB 3, AACI, and ACPI support right out of the box. And the easiest way to get it is with the Universal NT Installer. This project is basically a bootable ISO containing pre-configured Windows NT installations created using sysprep. That means we skip most installation prompts and we end up with a ready-to-go copy of Windows. Anyway, we're skipping the Universal NT Installer today since it would overwrite our current boot menu. There is no need to complicate things by bringing in another boot manager like Grub. So let's keep things simple. Now, to boot into Windows 2000, we need to do two things. Copy its pre-installed files onto our drive on a separate partition and then add a boot entry in the Windows Boot Manager. We could do this with BSOD edit, the built-in command line tool, but it's much easier with a graphical tool like EasyBSOD, where I can just click on add a new entry and EasyBSOD automatically detects the presence of the NT bootloader, which is NTLDR file in the root directory. And with that, in theory, we should be ready to boot. And yes, it booted and the process started with a disk check on the NVMe drive. The fact it could do that means we already had NVMe support, which is amazing, but then the setup froze during hardware detection. The usual suspect in this case is, well, a lot of things can go wrong, but especially ACPI. So my next step was to try running Windows 2000 from a SATA drive using a standard PC mode. This bypasses ACPI entirely and treats the system like a basic old-school 80s-style PC with one CPU and standard hardware. Did it work? Well, not quite. Next, I connected the same SATA drive to the VIA 6421 VCI to SATA controller, the one which initially made it possible to boot into Windows 98 on this M5 build. This time I was also counting on a custom Windows 2000 build with the VIA drivers already integrated, which had worked every time in the past. On paper it was a bulletproof plan, but it didn't work either. Then I remembered this tiny 2-port SATA controller I had lying around. It uses a GMB5H2 chip I'd never tried before, but I bought it for situations exactly like this. And what do you know? This little card did the trick. Windows 2000 finally booted in standard PC mode. The trade-off? We're not getting USB 3 or NVMe speeds in standard mode. We also can't use the backported drivers from the custom build. Does rely on a kernel extender workaround that provides missing APIs so newer drivers can work. But speaking of drivers, official ones install just fine. For example, the NVIDIA 7900GS GPU I'm also using in Windows 98 works in Windows 2000, of course. The only catch is that we need to disable the NVIDIA Servers Helper, since it slows boot times by about 20 to 30 seconds, even more. If we want USB support, that means adding a separate USB 2.0 card, which Windows 2000 Service Pack 4 should recognize automatically. I tried a PCIe card with an NEC chip, and sure enough, it worked straight away with the built-in drivers. As for the audio, the onboard Realtek ALC897 codec works perfectly, no issues at all. And here's the best part. This is all on stock Windows 2000 Service Pack 4 installation. The only extra thing we're using is the UniATA driver to boot from the SATA controller. So what can I say? Running Windows 2000 on a Ryzen 9 9900X build is pretty cool. Even in standard mode, with just one CPU and no power management whatsoever. But this still wasn't what I had in mind when I copied that pre-configured Windows 2000 installation over to the Kingston NVMe SSD. But wait, it gets better. Suddenly it started working from the NVMe drive too. So what changed? Well, it turns out that the trusty old VIA6421 PCI card was the culprit all along. It was getting stuck in an infinite loop during hardware detection. The second I removed it, Windows 2000 worked perfectly. After saving me so many times in the past, that card ended up causing a whole lot of unnecessary troubleshooting. Well, the card itself is fine, but most likely it's not getting the resources it needs from the BIOS, so neither its own driver nor UniATA could initialize it properly. Meanwhile, the GMB 5H2 controller is a 2018 design, so it's just a lot more versatile. Now that the system's running from NVMe, I was really curious about the performance. As I've shown here before, this Gen 5 Kingston Renegade Fury drive can deliver over 14 gigabytes per second. Obviously, Windows 2000 doesn't need anywhere near that much speed, but the fact it can even play in the same Gen 5 NVMe league is insane. Well, we don't quite hit the same numbers as in Windows 11, but seeing transfer speeds close to 12 gigabytes per second in Windows 2000 is still absolutely crazy. Next, I wanted to see if the GeForce 7900GS GPU would perform better here than it did in Windows 98, where it scored 56.2K points in 3DMark 2001 Second Edition. This card is also fully supported in Windows 2000, and the drivers are slightly newer, so I was hoping for a nice boost. Well, the results were a bit better, but not by a huge margin. We only gained about 1500 points. As for games, results are kinda mixed. 3D Mark ran fine, Quake 2 ran fine too, but some titles like Stalker or Far Cry behave really strangely. Instead of normal gameplay, they run in what looks like fast-forward hundreds of FPS even with VSync forced. Now, this isn't just a case of the hardware being too fast. I've tested these games on fast CPUs before and they behaved normally. So something here is broken in the timing, most likely driver bug. Here's Stalker, for example, and no, this footage isn't sped up. This is literally how the game launches. It just blasts for like a broken time demo. I'm sure I'll eventually track down a fix, but for now I'm just happy it's running at all. Alright, running Windows 2000 from an NVMe drive with ACPI, USB 3 and ACI all working is pretty mind-blowing. However, this won't solve software compatibility. The kernel extender that provides support for backported drivers won't help with new applications that expect at least Windows XP. So to push things further, we need to install the extended kernel by BlackWingCat. Think of this as a very unofficial service pack that makes Windows 2000 almost as compatible as Windows XP. The installation isn't too complicated, but first we need to get Windows 2000 completely up to date with the latest service pack, the update Rollup 1 and Internet Explorer service pack 1. For this part, we should use a legacy update which will install every update ever released. Once we're up to date and the extended kernel is in place, we can run several modern browsers. I went with the latest New Moon release from August 2025, which is basically Pale Moon with a few tweaks, And yes, everything works and looks as it should, especially on YouTube, which is quite demanding. In fact, running this updated build with the extended kernel almost makes you forget the foundation is a 25-year-old operating system. The GPU drivers, though, are a reminder that we are still on Windows 2000, since official support ended back in 2010, at least for NVIDIA cards. That means the best we can install is something from the NVIDIA 400 series, like this GTS 450, which runs natively without any workarounds. By the way, this is another AMD build with a first-gen Ryzen 7 and a B550 motherboard. If we want to push things even further, we can install something called the Extended Core, also by BlackWingCat. This brings XP level driver compatibility by integrating even more components from Windows XP. But at this point, you might ask yourself, why not just install Windows XP in the first place? It would be much easier. That's it for today. Thank you for watching. I'm already planning the next one, a Windows Millennium video, which was first released in September 2000. And as it happens, this month marks its 25th anniversary. I even have a few of the original OEM packages with their stickers. If it works on this build, and I'm sure it will, I'll probably end up putting a Windows ME sticker on this new case. Because why not?